I'm Indy Neidell, and this is another exciting episode of The Great War on the Road. And once again, I am in Turkey, and once again, I'm with John, our local historian. And today, I'm going to look at some of the northern locations from the Gallipoli campaign. We've already done a special on the southern locations. And there's a lot of wind here, so if the sound gets a little bear with us. We are standing right here now at ANZAC Cove, ANZAC being Australian and New Zealand Army Corps. And this was one of the first landings on April 25th when the land campaign began. And further to our north is Suvla Bay, which you can't see, but that became another front in August of 1915. Now, I'm not going to talk about the battles today.
Obviously.
Yeah. You can learn all about those in our regular weekly episode. But just standing here, we started thinking of some things that you don't normally think immediately about when you think about war and think about battles. Landing here, every single thing you do from the moment you're getting off the boats or even on the boats is under constant observation from the enemy above. I mean, the Ottomans were all up there, all the way up to Çanakkale, yep, and Gabatepe and beyond,
yep,
right?
Yep, yep.
So they could see every single thing that was happening.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that leads me right away to think of sanitation. You've got tens of thousands of men landing here. They have, you have dead bodies all over the place, which you have to try and dispose of, but you also have human waste. You can dig latrines, but that's under the watch of the enemy. They're firing artillery at that. They're shooting at you when you're using them, and maintaining adequate sanitation here became impossible after just the first few days, let alone after several months when it was the summer heat. So the dead bodies and the human waste bring flies. Flies carry disease,
yeah,
and you got all kinds of disease. You got typhus, malaria. Dysentery was not only a big disease, a big killer, to the point that by October, when Charles Monroe was estimating his troop strength, of his roughly 100,000 troops here, half of them were unfit for duty because of disease. Okay, but it wasn't just the Allies that were under constant enemy fire. The Ottomans were also constantly under fire from the Navy at sea,
yes,
right?
Yes, absolutely.
So while they didn't have quite the sanitation issues because they could go back,
yeah,
further and further, they did have logistics and supply issues of their own. Can you tell us?
Absolutely. Well, first of all, you have to keep into consideration that this is a very poor army,
yeah,
and they did not have any field kitchens. They did not have any continuous supply lines from Istanbul.
Trains.
There are no roads. Trains to speak of, no trucks, no roads, only mules and horses. And even that is tough because, as you've mentioned, they are under constant enemy and artillery fire. Also, the submarines in Marmara used to get rid of the supply ships that were being sent from Istanbul to Gallipoli.
So what'd they do then?
Well, in that case, the soldiers end up getting out of their trenches with the risk of being shot and finding fruits, vegetables, going to the nearby villages.
So no field kitchens,
no
so they
field
have to
kitchens.
Live off the land.
Exactly. And even getting a decent piece of meat or anything cooked was very difficult. In many cases, they really did not have much with them, and traditional Turkish food was hard to come by, actually, as a funny fact, sometimes they even fed themselves off by some of the friendly food thrown from the Australian side.
Okay.
So that's one thing. But also, it's important to mention that because these soldiers were not well fed and they didn't have any nutrition, additionally, the field hospital system wasn't very effective either.
Right.
And they really suffered from malaria. I mean, keep in mind that these are young kids that are coming from different parts of Anatolia,
sure.
And for them, proper medicine is something that is hard to come by.
Yeah.
So there were a lot of casualties because of malaria and other diseases that you mentioned on the Ottoman side as well.
Now, while the Ottomans did not have a strong organizational supply line, and the Allies did, that supply line still had a hell of a time bringing anything here. There's no fresh water in the region, right?
Yeah, yeah,
there were a
yeah.
couple of dug wells. They were destroyed by
yes,
artillery.
Yes, yes.
So all the water to feed, to for the cooking, the cleaning, and the drinking for tens of thousands of people had to be brought in by ship, and it had to be brought in from other countries. A lot of stuff was brought from Alexandria, and that's all the way across the Mediterranean.
Yeah,
and that's where the sick guys were evacuated to, because how can you have a field hospital when you can't even dig a latrine? You could be treated on the ship, or you could be treated in Alexandria. Those were pretty much your options. Now, so everything is a constant uphill struggle against an entrenched enemy. So why don't we take a closer look at some of the local terrain?
Yep, let's go ahead.
Okay, John, tell us about that.
Well, that is the Sphinx of Arıburnu. Okay. Now, Arıburnu translates as bee's nose in Turkish, and this is basically one of the most iconic terrain features of the Gallipoli campaign. It is so iconic that nearly all the paintings made about the Anzac landings by the Allied artists and all the stories about the Allied authors were based on the Sphinx, so it is very iconic.
Well, you can kind of see why, because from the landing, that's what, 1.5 kilometers, and that's exactly that high away, and you have to get past that and all these other heights. So everything was just a constant uphill struggle, and beyond that, to get all the way to Çanakkale and to Gabatepe. So why don't we go up to Çanakkale and look down and see the other direction?
Let's go ahead.
All right. Okay, this is Lone Pine, as you can see, a lone pine. And it's a fairly significant name for the Gallipoli campaign, right?
Yes, absolutely.
So let's talk about some of the things we associate with Lone Pine.
Well, first of all, the reason why it's called Lone Pine is obviously it's a lone pine, but it actually withstood the fighting here that happened in August 1915.
Which took out a lot of...
Which took out a lot of things other than humans. And this is also a place where a lot of the Australians and New Zealanders who fought here heroically came over to pay their respects for their ancestors.
It's funny that you say that, because looking at the memorial there, there are a lot of Australian, New Zealand names. There's also a lot of Indian names, though.
Exactly, exactly. That the Indian people who fought here for the British Empire have always been ignored in history, which is what they deserve, is to be recognized as along with the other people who fought here. There was actually Indian troops that fought in Gallipoli in the ANZAC front, okay. And they also had huge sacrifices.
Of course, there were a great many Irish soldiers that fought and died here as well.
Along with Newfoundlanders who actually fought in Cape Helles. They were the only North American troops that actually fought here,
okay.
Which is an interesting fact. We mentioned the French, of course, but also we had an Arab unit in the Ottoman army.
So the Ottoman army was multicultural.
Exactly.
Well.
You had Turks, you had Kurds, you had Armenians, Arabs, all around the empire, and they also came here and fought for their sultan.
Now, in a little while, we're gonna talk about the renewed attack fighting at Suvla Bay.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, and this is a scene of big diversionary action right there.
Absolutely. Yeah. The Allied command rather imagined that in order to have landings in Suvla Bay, they need to create a diversion so the Ottoman forces would not be welcoming the Allied troops that are going to land. Now, these diversionary attacks were not very well planned,
right.
And there was heavy fighting that was going on here, and some of the Ottoman commanders realized that something big was going on, even though they didn't have a navy to check which ships are being loaded and unloaded. So this is one of the spots where for 5 days there was intense fighting.
I mean, as a diversion.
Diversion. Yeah. I mean, we're standing on the graves of nearly 600 people. Of course, the Allied soldiers were buried here, and the Turks were buried elsewhere. And the Turkish name for this place is called Kanlısırt, which translates as the Bloody Hill.
Okay.
And there was also another diversionary attack at the Neck,
okay.
Which is, of course, Australians would know, both from the 1981 movie by Peter Weir, Gallipoli, the charge of the light horse.
Right.
Now, that was a disastrous attack because, first of all, the Australians were without any bullets in their rifles so they can run faster. They literally attacked a Turkish position that was swarmed with machine guns, and the attack was renewed 4 times. It's one of the most tragic episodes in Gallipoli, and the youth of the Western Australia was mowed down at the Neck.
Now, it's interesting you say that, because yes, that was one of the most tragic episodes at Gallipoli on the Allied side,
yeah.
But you also had such tragedies on the Ottoman side.
Yes, exactly. This is something that is we consider one of the greatest tragedies, not only for the war, but for the start of the new Turkish Republic.
What you're just about to tell them.
Yes. Okay. On 19th of May 1915, the Ottoman High Command decided to drive the Australians to the sea. It's a common word that we use in Turkish, drive the enemy to the sea. And the Australians had been fighting for nearly a month,
yeah.
Uphill, under fire, under constant observation, and they prepared their trenches and they dug and they dug and they dug. and the Turkish forces at that time were preparing for a sneak attack, but the Turkish troops were not trained for a sneak attack. Now, the reason why it's so tragic is because there were lots of university students, the educated youth of Istanbul,
right,
who were hastily brought up together.
So they weren't really trained.
They were not trained, and they arrived in Gallipoli in the middle of the night. Imagine coming here. I mean, during the day with maps, you can find whatever you want, but without proper guidance, they came here in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
And it was supposed to be a sneak attack, but the Australians were, they were awake and ready at their guns, and they knew something was going to happen. And the Turks got out of their trenches, started running at the Australians as a sneak attack, but then, of course, they were mowed down by machine gun fire, just like at the Neck.
Yeah.
Now, the reason why this is a tragedy is because so many educated men died there. Then in the following years, in the 20s, when the Turkish Republic was being established, we did not have the brain power.
We had a shortage.
Yeah, a shortage of brain power, intellectual power. And basically, also, but that battle also had a significant consequence. After the battle, the Allies and the Turks decided on an armistice because of the heat the bodies were smelling, and it was awful. And in that armistice, for the first time, the Turks and the Australians saw each other face to face. And all the stories about how Turkish men were eating humans, as the British were saying, or as the Turkish propaganda was, the Australians were barbarians, barbaric people, it immediately disappeared in that armistice.
Well, there's still like a fair amount of friendship between
exactly
people.
Yeah, because I mean, it's one of the, there's nothing nice about war, but at least it brought people thousands of miles away from each other. I mean, after that armistice, there were exchanges of food between the trenches.
Yeah.
They were doing little games, like the Turks would put up a target and the Australians would try to shoot it. They were various exchanges of food, which is interesting because the Australians used to throw cans of bully beef to the Turks, and the Turks thought that it had pork in it and they didn't want to eat it. Yeah, just give us something else. But right now in Australia, there are lots of memorials for the war.
Yeah.
And over here as well in Turkey, we have lots of memorials for the Anzacs. And there's a very, very strong friendship between the Turks, the Australians, and the New Zealanders, which I'm very happy about.
Okay, and now we're going to move along to Chinook Bear, which we talked about all the time, and you'll finally get to see it. These are the heights of Chinook Bear. Now, as you can see behind me, you have a commanding view of ANZAC Cove, of Suvla Bay. So from the very beginning, the Ottomans could see exactly what was going on. They could see the landings. They knew what was coming, how much was coming. So this position is a very, very strong strategic value. This was also actually the farthest that the Allies got. During the Suvla attacks in August, the New Zealanders had a diversionary attack here, and they actually managed to take Chinook Bear. They held it for 2 days, but they could not be reinforced. As you can see, it's a real struggle just to fight up here in the first place, so reinforcing it is incredibly tough. So after a couple of days, they were forced from the position, and this was the farthest they got.
Yeah, exactly. And during the war between the New Zealander forces and the Turkish forces, there was hand-to-hand combat, and the Maori unit of the New Zealander force was here.
Okay.
And it was quite a heroic story for both sides. But, I mean, you know, not having weapons, it must have been very brutal.
Well, yeah, and it's funny because you know that the Ottomans could see everything coming, right?
Exactly.
Now, to negate that advantage or to even the score, the Allies are going to have to see what's going on up here with the Ottomans. Now, how did they do that?
Well, they did it with aircraft. They got the aircraft on the Greek islands that are close to Gallipoli, and they also had an aircraft carrier, well, very simple one, of course, which had a squadron of observation and fighter planes,
right,
which flew over here. Now, of course, at that time, there were no radios in aircraft,
right,
so the Allied plans, the planes used to look down, they used to note down the positions, fly back to their base and give the information to the responsible parties.
But that takes time.
That takes time. So Turks, with their practical intelligence then, used to get out of the trenches, get their material out, and by the time the Navy started bombarding, they were just getting soil up in the air.
Okay.
Which was, and of course there was the Turkish squadron which kept harassing the Allied aircraft. That was a contingent of German and Turkish pilots.
Okay, but it wasn't, okay, we've seen it's a marine war,
yeah,
it's an infantry war, there's a war in the air. What about cavalry? What about horses?
Well, cavalry is something that obviously the Allies could not use much. The Australian Light Horse Brigade was here, regiment was here, and they couldn't use their horses because there was no space to use them. There were some mules, of course, to carry water and artillery pieces. On the Turkish side, the cavalry was very important because that's the only kind of transportation the Turks had. There were not many trucks and there were no train lines here, so the officers used to go from one front to the other on horseback.
Okay.
And mules, of course.
Okay, so you could see more of a cavalry war for the Ottomans,
yeah,
than for the Allies. Now, when Sir Ian Hamilton was replaced in October and Charles Monroe took over, his first reaction was, this is unsustainable.
Yes.
We have no sanitation. We have terrible supply problems. They can see everything we do. We can't make any headway. It's been 6 months. So he said, when Lord Kitchener asked him, what do you think we should do? He said, I think we should evacuate. Now, Kitchener at first did not believe him, mm-hmm, because Hamilton had written all these reports like, ah, the situation's great. It's, yeah, not so bad. And at first said, no, I don't believe you. But then Kitchener came here and he looked around and after like a minute said, yeah, okay, time to go.
Exactly.
So I'm just, looking here on a beautiful day, you can see, oh, beautiful territory. But just imagine the hell that it was 103 years ago.
Yeah, so. Exactly. And for the Turks, of course, the battle was also draining manpower,
sure,
and supplies. So when the Allies left, it was, it was not entirely a success for the Turks. It was a victory, of course, but they could not catch the Allies running. And basically that was covered in another episode. So
yeah,
for the evacuation. And of course, this front, this part of Gallipoli is also something significant with regards to a certain individual,
yeah,
that we covered, right?
Mustafa Kemal.
Mustafa Kemal. Now, Mustafa Kemal was an officer in the Ottoman army who had lots of initiative and practical thinking. And he was the one who actually managed to stop the capture of Çanakkale after the New Zealanders held it for a few days. And he was also responsible for ordering his troops to die, not to attack, and
yeah,
that was the kind of encouragement he gave. Now, there's something very interesting about the man, because he was always close to combat. He was always a frontline commander,
right,
and there was even an instance where he was ahead of his soldiers and to encourage them.
Yeah.
So Gallipoli made him famous, and 20 years after the war, he had a very interesting quotation that is now world famous, and a lot of Turks are proud of it. There is a plaque in ANZAC Cove, which on it writes, "The mother of the children who've sent your sons to us, after fighting in this land, they have become our sons as well." And this was in 1934.
When you think about it, because everybody fighting on both sides was somebody's mother's son.
Yes.
Okay, John, well, thank you very much for
today.
Thank
you for coming. Thank you.
If you guys would like to see the special we did at Cape Helles, you can click right here for that. And you can also check out our subreddit for all kinds of interesting World War I information. And if you haven't subscribed, don't forget to do so. See you next time.